and the Prime Minister of the Republic of Italy.
Please have a seat. It is a great pleasure to welcome my partner and friend, Prime Minister Renzi, to the White House. Benvenuto. I actually should say welcome back. Not many people know this, but Matteo came to the White House several years ago. Back then he was the young, dynamic mayor of Florence. Today he's the young, dynamic Prime Minister of Italy. But even then, I think people recognize that he brought an energy and a sense of vision to where he wanted to see his country go. And today is an opportunity for me to return the incredible hospitality that Matteo and the Italian people showed me last year in Rome, one of the great cities of the world. Italy, of course, is one of our closest and strongest allies. And anytime Italians and Americans get together, it's also a chance to celebrate the deep bonds of history and friendship and family. As I said before, I'm not lucky enough to have any Italian ancestry that I know of. But I consider myself an honorary Italian because I love all things Italian. And the United States would not be what we are or who we are without the contributions of generations of Italian Americans. In Rome last year, Matteo spoke eloquently of his visits to the American military cemetery in Florence. And that's a reminder of how Italians and Americans have made extraordinary sacrifices for the freedom that we cherish. And I'm also grateful for my partnership personally with Prime Minister Renzi. We've worked together on several occasions, from Rome to our NATO, G7, and G20 summits. I know he is deeply committed to our alliance. Moreover, I have been very impressed with the energy and the vision and the reforms that he is pursuing to unleash the potential of the Italian people and the Italian economy. His willingness to challenge the status quo and to look to the future has made him a leading voice in Europe, and we're already seeing progress being made with respect to Italy. So, Matteo, I want to thank you again for the seriousness and sense of purpose that you bring to our work together here today. This morning, we focused on our shared security, starting in Europe. We agreed that the international community needs to continue supporting Ukraine with robust assistance as it pursues economic and political reforms. Along with our international partners, we strongly support the Minsk agreements, and we agree that both Russia and the Ukraine must fulfill all the obligations under these agreements. I thank the Prime Minister of Italy's strong support for the international coalition against ISIL. Italy, by the way, is one of the largest contributors of advisors and trainers to help build up Iraqi security forces, and Italy is leading the effort to ensure the area is liberated from ISIL's control or stabilized with an effective civilian police force. We also spent a considerable amount of time discussing our deep shared concern for the situation in Libya, where we continue to support UN efforts to form a unity government. Given Italy's leadership role across the Mediterranean, the Prime Minister and I agreed to work together even more intensively to encourage cooperation on threats coming from Libya, including the growing ISIL presence there, as well as additional coordination with other partners in how we can stabilize what has become a very deadly and difficult situation. More broadly, Italian forces continue to play a vital role from Kosovo to Lebanon to Afghanistan. Coalition forces continue to train and assist Afghan forces, and we want to make sure we transition responsibly as we complete our consolidation by the end of next year. I updated Prime Minister Renzi on the framework that we reached with Iran, our progress towards a comprehensive deal that prevents Iran from obtaining a nuclear weapon, and we agreed that until any final deal is reached, sanctions on Iran must continue to be fully and strictly enforced. So that's what we talked about in the morning. After this press conference, we'll have lunch, and that'll give us a chance to focus on what is clearly the top priority of both our peoples, and that is creating a strong, inclusive economy that is creating jobs and opportunity on both sides of the Atlantic. Like me, Prime Minister Renzi is a strong supporter of TTIP, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, which would boost both jobs and exports in Europe and the United States, and would include strong protections for workers and public health and safety and the environment. Now that Congress is considering important bipartisan legislation for trade promotion authority, TTIP negotiations need to make major progress this year. I'm looking forward to hearing the Prime Minister's assessment of the ambitious economic reforms that he's pursuing to make Italy more competitive and to reinvigorate the Italian economy as a source of growth in Europe. We'll be discussing Europe's effort to find paths that builds on recent reforms to return Greece to growth within the Eurozone. And we'll be discussing the importance of all our major economies taking ambitious action on climate change. During its presidency of the EU, Italy showed real leadership as Europe committed to new targets for reducing emissions. My work with Prime Minister Renzi today is part of our continuing effort to forge a strong climate agreement in Paris this year. And finally, I want to congratulate Italy and the people of Milan as they prepare to host the 2015 World Expo. The focus is on food, something that Italy knows something about, along with wine. But the Expo and our U.S. pavilion is focused not only on outstanding cuisine, like Italy's, but also how we feed a growing planet, how we combat hunger and malnutrition, how we put healthy food on our tables. And that's a cause, obviously, that's very close to Michelle's heart. So we commend Italy's leadership, and I suspect many Americans will be visiting Milan and sampling the food and sampling the wine. Matteo, grazie for your leadership in Italy and Europe, for your partnership on many pressing global issues. I assure you that it is a friendship and partnership that all Americans treasure, and we are grateful that we have such strong bonds between our peoples. Prime Minister.
Thank you so much, Mr. President. Thank you so much. It's really an honor for me and for every member of Italian government to be here in the White House in the heart of freedom around the world. Parlerò in italiano molto rapidamente per ringraziare il Presidente degli Stati Uniti d'America per la straordinaria leadership che sta esprimendo sia a livello di politica estera che nel modello economico e di sviluppo. Noi ci siamo visti l'ultima volta a Brisbane durante il G20. Non posso che apprezzare da partner e alleato il lavoro svolto dagli Stati Uniti d'America nella complessa vicenda di Cuba, un passaggio storico non soltanto per il popolo americano e per il popolo cubano, ma una straordinaria occasione per tutto il mondo e per nella vicenda iraniana, cui l'Unione Europea ha collaborato e continuerà a collaborare, perché il framework, il quadro, la cornice di accordo possa trovare una conclusione entro il 30 di giugno. Aggiungo, nell'entrare alla Casa Bianca, che porto con me e a nome di tutti gli italiani i sentimenti di orgoglio per ciò che il Presidente ha detto anche adesso circa l'importanza del ruolo di tante italiane e italiani nella storia degli Stati Uniti, da Cristoforo Colombo in poi, ma anche la gratitudine per il sacrificio di giovani uomini degli Stati Uniti d'America che proprio in questi giorni ricordiamo per i 70 anni della liberazione dell'Italia. Noi italiani siamo molto orgogliosi del lavoro che hanno fatto i partigiani, cioè gli italiani che decisero di dire no al fascismo e al nazismo e salirono sulle montagne per combattere per la pace e per la libertà, ma sappiamo anche che non sarebbe stato possibile tutto ciò senza l'impegno, il sacrificio dell'esercito americano, di giovani ragazzi che neanche conoscevano l'Italia, ma che sono morti per mio nonno, per mio padre, per la mia famiglia, per i miei figli. E per questo, in questi giorni di celebrazioni in Italia, mi recherò anche in celebrazioni per i 70 anni della liberazione, in un luogo che mi è particolarmente caro, il cimitero americano di San Casciano, per portare il tributo a tutto il popolo americano, che vorrei estendere a te, caro Presidente, ringraziandoti a nome di tutti gli italiani. Abbiamo discusso molto, abbiamo discusso di tante questioni molto importanti. Sono ansioso di discutere con il Presidente Obama delle questioni legate all'economia. Se voi guardate questi ultimi 7 anni, 2008-2015, l'economia americana ha visto ridurre il numero di disoccupati ed è cresciuto il GDP. L'economia europea ha visto aumentare il numero dei disoccupati e è diminuito il PIL, il GDP. Qualcosa non ha funzionato a casa nostra. Per questo motivo ritengo che l'esperienza del governo degli Stati Uniti sia un modello per l'economia europea e che dobbiamo stare molto attenti al budget, ai limiti, agli impegni che ci siamo presi, ma occorre anche una nuova stagione di crescita e di investimenti. Nel 2014 abbiamo iniziato con le prime misure, ma ancora c'è molto da fare e la leadership americana è un punto di riferimento. Abbiamo discusso, come il Presidente ha detto, di Libia. Esco dall'incontro con la convinzione di una piena condivisione con gli Stati Uniti, con il Presidente e con il suo team. Nelle prossime settimane questa piena condivisione mostrerà i frutti più efficaci. Da subito voglio dire che ciò che accade nel Mar Mediterraneo non è solo una questione di sicurezza, ed è evidentemente una questione di sicurezza, ma anche una questione di giustizia e di dignità dell'uomo. E in questo senso l'autorevole collaborazione che gli Stati Uniti possono offrire è per noi un elemento di grande importanza. Abbiamo discusso della situazione ucraina e russa, come ha ricordato il Presidente. Abbiamo discusso delle questioni legate all'Iran, al complicato quadro del Medio Oriente, e io credo che sia molto importante per noi sottolineare come far parte di questa grande alleanza che gli Stati Uniti guidano è un punto di riferimento non soltanto per le singole scelte, ma anche per la battaglia di valori, di ideali, direi la battaglia culturale che ciascuno di noi deve fare. Per questo motivo, caro Presidente, caro Barack, arrivando qua, ho scelto di partire da una università, da Georgetown University, e lasciando la Casa Bianca mi recherò molto rapidamente alla National Gallery per una mostra sul Rinascimento italiano e fiorentino, segno evidente che la cultura e la valorizzazione di ciò che può fare un ragazzo, una ragazza che studia, il capitale umano, l'investimento sul domani è il vero motore della nostra civiltà e del nostro futuro. Anche per questo Expo sarà una grande occasione. Mi sono anticipato portando qualche bottiglia di vino a Barack, che so essere un grande esperto. Io ricordo, I remember an interview with an Italian journalist when he was candidate about Tuscan wine. I remember very well a very important interview about it. Ma credo che sia molto importante per noi, indipendentemente dalle battute sul vino e sul cibo, fare dell'Expo una grande occasione per la qualità della vita, per il lifestyle e anche per dichiarare guerra alla povertà. Non è possibile che continuiamo ad avere un mondo in cui 1 miliardo di persone muore per l'obesità e 1 miliardo di persone muore perché non ha cibo. Anche questo sarà l'Expo. E la presenza degli Stati Uniti d'America sarà per noi un elemento di fondamentale importanza. Grazie di cuore, e se posso chiudere su questo, lasciatemi concludere dicendo che anche se non riguarda i rapporti tra governi, ho detto al Presidente Obama appena arrivato che lo volevo ringraziare per il suo speech a Selma. È una cosa personale, ma è anche una grande questione politica. Ci sono dei momenti in cui la storia fa gli straordinari, e uno di questi momenti è sicuramente quello che questo paese ha vissuto negli ultimi 50 anni. Credo che per chi vuole bene alla politica, quel discorso sia stato un momento di grandissima ispirazione e di forte riflessione. Anche per questo, grazie mille, Presidente, e grazie della calda accoglienza alla Casa Bianca.
Thank you very much. Let me just be clear that with respect to the wine, I felt it would be insulting for me not to sample it and to establish the strong commercial bonds between the United States and America when it comes to Tuscan wine. So I will give you, Matteo, a report on whether it's up to the quality that we expect. With that, let me call on Roberta Rampton of Reuters. There we go.
Thanks. President Obama, some congressional leaders yesterday came to a deal on fast track for trade, but it's clear that many in your party are opposed, including Senator Schumer. And are you worried that your support for this is going to divide your party going into 2016? And will it hurt your party's ability to win? Do you need Hillary Clinton's support on this? And Prime Minister, how confident are you that Greece will reach an agreement with its creditors by the end of this month? And how concerned are each of you about the effects that this could have on the global economy if a deal is not reached?
On trade, first of all, I want to congratulate Senators Wyden and Hatch for coming up with a bipartisan framework for trade promotion authority. And without getting into the weeds on it, I think it's important to recognize that the trade promotion authority is not the same as a trade agreement. It just gives us a structure whereby when a trade agreement is presented, it can move forward in a quicker fashion and not get completely bogged down in the usual procedures. And I would be receiving the same trade promotion authority that every president in the post-war era, with the exception of Richard Nixon, has received. So it's not exceptional in that sense. What is exceptional is that in this framework, for the first time, there are requirements for enforceable labor, environmental provisions. There is a clear attention to issues like human rights. And in many ways, this is the most far-reaching and progressive trade promotion authority that we've seen going through Congress. And that's important because, as I've said before, it is entirely understandable that there is some skepticism around trade from working families who live in a town that saw manufacturing collapse and jobs being outsourced. People recognize that there have been circumstances in the past in which trade may have contributed to aggregate growth of the global economy or even the U.S. economy, but hurt workers. And we've learned lessons from that. And this Trade Promotion Authority, thanks to the work of Senator Wyden and Hatch, reflects some of those lessons. Now, in terms of actually getting a deal done, the first trade agreement that we potentially would present under this Trade Promotion Authority would be the Trans-Pacific Partnership, or TPP. I've spoken to this before, but I will just repeat that 95% of the world's markets are outside our borders. The fastest growing markets, the most populous markets, are going to be in Asia. And if we do not help to shape the rules so that our businesses and our workers can compete in those markets, then China will set up rules that advantage Chinese workers and Chinese businesses. And that will set the stage over the next 20, 30 years for us being locked out, us being unable to protect our businesses from discrimination, our agricultural products being excluded from these areas, high tariffs that prevent us from being able to compete fairly. When it comes to services or it comes to the internet, for example, our ability to maintain intellectual property protection or freedom in the internet or other requirements that tilt the playing field against U.S. workers, that's what's going to happen. So what we are doing is negotiating the highest level, highest standard trade agreement in our history with strong enforceable labor provisions, strong enforceable environmental provisions. And I will be able to show, when the final agreement is presented, that this is absolutely good for not just American businesses, but for American workers. And it's good for our economy. It's the right thing to do. Now, last point I'll make on this, the politics around trade has always been tough, particularly in the Democratic Party, because people have memories of outsourcing and job loss. The point I've made to my labor friends and my progressive friends is that, you know, companies that are looking for just low-cost labor, they've already left. We're already at a disadvantage right now. And the trade agreement I'm proposing would actually strengthen our ability to force other markets open and strengthen our position compared to where we are right now. And being opposed to this new trade agreement is essentially a ratification of the status quo, where a lot of folks are selling here, but we're not selling there. Japan is one of the negotiators in this deal. Now, last time I checked, if you drive around Washington, there are a whole bunch of Japanese cars. You go to Tokyo and count how many Chryslers and GM and Ford cars there are. So the current situation is not working for us. And I don't know why it is that folks would be opposed to us opening up the Japanese market more for U.S. autos or U.S. beef. Doesn't make any sense. So I'm going to be able to make a strong case, but I think it's important when you talk about dividing the party. Look, we got a Korean free trade agreement passed, we got a Colombian free trade agreement passed, and a Panama free trade agreement passed over the last several years during my presidency. It didn't divide the Democratic Party. There's going to be a set of Democratic senators and House members who traditionally have just on principle opposed trade because the unions on principle, regardless of what the provisions are opposed to trade. And then there are the others who, like me, believe that we cannot stop a global economy at our shores. We've got to be in there and compete. And we've got to make sure we're writing the rules so that we've got a level playing field, because when we do, products made in America, services provided by American firms are the best in the world. I will continue to make that argument. And for those who argue that somehow this is contrary to the interests of working families, what I tell them is my whole presidency has been about helping working families and lifting up wages and giving workers more opportunity. And if I didn't think this deal was doing it, I wouldn't do it. I didn't get elected because of the sponsorship of the Business Roundtable or the Chamber of Commerce. Those aren't the ones who brought me to the dance. The reason I'm doing it is because I know this is an important thing to do, and I also know that it sends a signal throughout Asia that we are out there competing and that we are going to help maintain international rules that are fair for everybody and not so tilted in favor of one country it ends up being bad for not only our commercial prospects, but for other countries over the long term. That was a very long answer, but it's a big question, and I hadn't had a chance to talk about it. Sorry, Matteo.
Very, very briefly, I think, yes, I'm confident, but at the same time, I'm worried, because obviously the situation in Greece is not, the situation in Europe is not the 2011, is not around the world 2008, so it's different time, but we must absolutely strongly work to achieve an agreement. to achieve this agreement, it's important Greece government respect not all the agreements of the past, because in the European Council we accept a very normal principle: if there is a moment of election and there is a new leader, it's correct to respect the vote of citizens, in this case the vote of citizens in Greece. But there are a framework of agreement in the European institutions which very important Greek government must respect. At the same time, we must for the future write a new page in the European economics. I am absolutely confident about it. It's finished the time of only austerity in Europe. But to achieve this goal, the local government, the national government, must do reforms. This is important, first of all, for Italy. We are absolutely committed to realize every reform promised to our citizens, not European institutions, to our citizens. And then we can finally open a discussion about the relation between austerity and growth in European economy. But now it's the time to respect the new framework of agreement, and we will work in this direction.
Mario Calvo Platero, Sole 24 Ore. Presidente, alcune delle sue riforme, delle sue promesse di riforma hanno già portato investitori americani in Italia. Ecco, ora vorrebbero sapere questi investitori quando verranno, quando saranno concluse queste riforme. Può darci dei tempi precisi? Poi, appena parlato adesso di austerità e crescita, i mercati sono un po' preoccupati, noi abbiamo ancora una finanza pubblica in difficoltà. Ecco, come può rassicurare i mercati? Come può conciliare una diminuzione dell'austerità nel momento in cui la nostra finanza pubblica è ancora in difficoltà? E poi una sua posizione sul TTIP, perché ne ha parlato il Presidente. Mr. President, Mario Platero, you've complained time and again about Germany holding Europe hostage to its inflationary obsessions. Now you have just heard from Mr. Renzi that things are changing in Europe, that there are pro-growth policies, especially with the ECB taking action, with QE action. Is that enough? Have Europe and Italy done enough? Is your complaint over Germany over? And on Libya, did you agree or did you discuss a sale of drones to Italy? Thank you.
Tre domande in una. Three questions in one. It's a special offer by Il Sole 24 Ore.
Specialist at that.
Primo, timeline riforme. Credo di poter dire che gli investitori americani che vogliono investire in Italia, ma anche gli investitori italiani, hanno finalmente un mercato del lavoro più flessibile. Fatto. Anzi, diciamo in un altro modo, realizzato. Hanno un sistema istituzionale della giustizia, del fisco e della pubblica amministrazione che nei prossimi sei mesi sarà completato. Quindi quello che deve essere chiaro è che anche se in Italia c'è chi tutte le volte vorrebbe ripartire da zero, le riforme hanno preso la strada senza possibilità di essere bloccate. Già adesso chi vuole investire trova un mercato del lavoro più semplice, trova una qualità degli ingegneri, dei lavoratori, delle persone che stanno in Italia straordinaria. Quello che probabilmente servirà nei prossimi mesi sarà un grande investimento in education, perché nel mondo globale la chiave di volta per poter continuare ad avere l'Italia tra i paesi leader non è il numero degli abitanti, siamo non tanti, non è più forse neanche semplicemente la posizione, anche se siamo in una posizione strategica, quello che conterà è se gli italiani potranno offrire capitale umano, idee, sviluppo e futuro. Sulla politica di austerità, Io credo che sia importante una cosa molto semplice: dire che dobbiamo tenere in ordine i conti, ma contemporaneamente il modo migliore per vincere la crisi è scommettere sulla crescita. Gli Stati Uniti sono il nostro modello. Nell'ultimo riunione di Consiglio europeo, due riunioni fa, non nell'ultima, il presidente Juncker e il presidente Draghi hanno mostrato le slide con i risultati degli Stati Uniti e dell'Europa di questi ultimi 7 anni. E naturalmente sono un ottimo attestazione di stima per gli Stati Uniti, ma dimostrano che l'Europa basata soltanto sull'austerity non va da nessuna parte. Non è possibile, ne abbiamo discusso a Brisbane ed è stato decisivo anche in quel caso il ruolo del presidente Obama, continuare a guardare soltanto al bilancio come limite. Ovviamente è importante mantenere gli impegni, l'Italia sta mantenendo tutti gli impegni ed è il paese in Europa che sta rispettando tutte le regole che l'Europa si è dato, anche quelle che non condivide. Infine sul TTIP, per noi è un grande obiettivo, pensiamo che il 2015 debba essere l'anno della svolta. Come governo italiano stiamo spingendo con grande determinazione, non soltanto perché sappiamo che con il TTIP l'Italia ha tutto da guadagnare dal punto di vista commerciale o economico, ma soprattutto perché pensiamo che nel momento in cui gli Stati Uniti giustamente fanno accordi commerciali con la Cina, con l'Oriente, con tante parti del mondo, sia fondamentale come principio chiave avere uno stesso rapporto nella logica della nostra storica amicizia tra Europa e Stati Uniti. All'interno del nostro partito noi rappresentiamo il partito, quello che mi piacerebbe un giorno chiamare il Partito Democratico a livello europeo. Il nostro partito è convinto e sostiene la posizione anche nonostante ci siano delle resistenze, in particolar modo dei socialdemocratici tedeschi, ma sono assolutamente convinto, determinato a trovare gli accordi necessari. Ne parleremo anche durante il pranzo.
Well, first of all, let me make sure that I correct the impression that I have consistently criticized Germany. Chancellor Merkel is a great friend and a great ally. From the time I came into office, when we were in the midst of the Great Recession, there have been competing economic theories in terms of what's the best way to pull us out of a financially induced crisis of this scale. It was our strong belief that it was important for us to make the investments to boost demand, to put money in the pockets of consumers, to strengthen and fortify the banking system so that we wouldn't see a repeat of the kinds of bailout practices and irresponsible practices on Wall Street. And that the best way to bring down the deficit was not just to cut spending, but to grow the economy, as well as initiate the kinds of structural reforms around healthcare and education and research and development that were going to be important for long-term growth. And I think we've largely succeeded in stabilizing the economy and then putting it on a growth trajectory. We've now seen 5 straight years of job growth. We've gone from a 10% unemployment rate down to 5.5. And we've done this while reducing the deficit by 2/3, primarily because the economy grew much faster. And you know, it's been my view with respect to Europe that it's not an either-or situation, but it's a both-and situation. Sometimes it gets framed as, what's the right answer for Europe? Is it austerity or is it structural reform? And my attitude has been, yes, you need structural reforms of the sort that Matteo is initiating. If the labor markets are too stuck, then it's very hard to hire, particularly for young people. If there's too much bureaucracy to start a new business, then businesses will go elsewhere, or talented entrepreneurs will start businesses someplace else. So I think Prime Minister Renzi's government is on the right track in initiating the kinds of structural reforms that Angela Merkel and other economists have called on for a long time. But what I've also said is that at a time of such low demand and hints of deflation that we were seeing in Europe over the course of the last several years, boosting demand is also important. Having some flexibility in meeting fiscal targets is also important. The sustainability of structural reforms depends on people feeling some sense of hope and some sense of progress. And if all it is just getting squeezed, but there's no growth, then over time the political consensus breaks down, and not only do you not get structural reforms, but you also end up reverting to some of the old patterns that didn't work. And so I think that the approach that Matteo is describing is the right one. Move forward on the structural reforms, but have flexibility and a strategy for increasing demand, increasing investments. And by the way, here in the United States, we're not done. I'd like to see us rebuild our infrastructure across this country. That's a smart investment to make right now. It would put people back to work. It would boost additional demand. More workers would be employed. They would then spend money. You'd get a virtuous cycle, but it's also something that we need to do to stay competitive. So it's a smart combination. So this is not just a criticism of Europe. I think globally, all of us have to recognize global aggregate demand is still very weak. And China is making some necessary transitions towards a more consumer-based rather than export-based economy, but that means that they're not going to be growing as fast. And that in turn has meant that suppliers of raw materials to China are seeing their economies soften. And what I've said to the Europeans is don't expect that the United States is simply going to be the engine for everybody. Don't expect that you can just keep on selling to the United States, but we can't sell anything to you because your economy is so weak. That won't benefit anybody. And those are concerns that I've expressed across the board. And this, finally, the last point I would make, this applies to Greece as well. I think Matteo's right. Greece needs to initiate reforms. They have to collect taxes. They have to reduce their bureaucracy. They have to have more flexible labor practices. And when the new prime minister came in, I called him and I said, we recognize you need to show your people that there's hope and that you can grow. And we will be supportive of some flexibilities in how you move forward so that you can make investments. And it's not just squeezing blood from a stone. But you have to show those who are extending credit, those who are supporting your financial system, that you're trying to help yourself. And that requires making the kinds of tough decisions that I think Matteo's beginning to make. We did not discuss drones. We did not. Last question from this side is Margaret Tell.
Thank you, Mr. President, Prime Minister Renzi. Mr. President, I would like to ask you about Iran, but before we forget, I'm hoping at the end of your answer, you might also bring us up to speed a little bit on Loretta Lynch's prospects for confirmation as your AG. Have you done enough? What do you make of Republicans' most recent moves? Where's this thing going? On Iran, so much has happened, and so this is going to be one of my
just a general
three-part questions. No. The Cardin-Corker compromise this week really was a pretty significant concession from you, and what I'm wondering is, do you believe that you've now weathered any more congressional sort of bids to derail this, or are you concerned that because Israel and Iran have now become deeply polarized issues, there's going to be more to fend off? And you have suggested, but you have not said explicitly, that there must be a phase-out rather than the immediate lifting of sanctions in order for you to agree to a final deal. Can you be definitive on that in exchange? Might you be willing to release part or all of that $100 billion or so in frozen oil assets that Iran has in offshore accounts? And you seem to be floating the idea that you might want to say something about Russia lifting its ban on the sale of missiles to Iran, so I will throw that your way. Prime Minister Renzi, I'd wanted to ask you about drones, but since that shockingly didn't come up, there's been some deeply troubling news about some of the migrants trying to come from Libya to Italy, violence, reports of violence by Muslims and pushing the Christians off the boats. And what I wanted to ask you is, how are you managing this? Are you confident that Italy is able to control the risk of extremists coming into Europe through Italy? Thank you.
All right. I wrote them down. On Iran. I thought Bob Corker and Ben Cardin came to a reasonable compromise. I had two concerns from the start with respect to any steps taken by Congress. The first was to make sure that their actions did not derail or prevent us being able to get the best deal possible. And John Kerry, when he is in those negotiations, not being hobbled or his life being made more complicated by congressional actions until we actually have a deal done. My basic argument was, let us show you if there's a deal or not. If there is, you'll have ample opportunity to review it and opine on it. But right now we're still negotiating, so have some patience. And I think the final product that emerged out of the Corker-Cardin negotiations, we believe will not derail the negotiations. So that checked off one box. The second concern I had was just an issue of presidential prerogatives. There were a number of people who were supporting Corker's legislation, suggesting that as a routine matter, a president needs to get sign-off from Congress to negotiate political agreements. That is not the case. That has never been the case. This is not a formal treaty that is being envisioned. And the President of the United States, whether Democrat or Republican, traditionally has been able to enter into political agreements that are binding with other countries without congressional approval. And I still have some concerns about the suggestion that that tradition was in some ways changing, but there was language in the legislation that spoke to this being directly related to congressional sanctions. And that, I think, at least allows me to interpret the legislation in such a way that it is not sending a signal to future presidents that each and every time they're negotiating a political agreement that they have to get a congressional authorization. So the final thing I'll say about the Corker legislation is that both Senator Corker and Senator Cardin, at least in my understanding, agreed that there's not going to be a whole bunch of poison pills or additional provisions or amendments added to it, and that they will be protective of this being a straightforward, fair process for Congress to be able to evaluate any deal that we may come up with, and and then register its views, but that it's not going to be tilted in the direction of trying to kill the deal. I take them at their word on that. We'll continue to monitor that. But assuming that what lands on my desk is what Senators Corker and Cardin agreed to, I will sign it. And that will then give Congress an opportunity to see, do we have a deal that reflects the political agreement that I talked about earlier? I expect that it will. With respect to the issue of sanctions coming down, I don't want to get out of ahead of John Kerry and my negotiators in terms of how to craft this. I would just make a general observation, and that is that how sanctions are lessened, how we snap back sanctions if there's a violation. There are a lot of different mechanisms and ways to do that. Part of John's job and part of the Iranian negotiator's job and part of the P5 plus one's job is to sometimes find formulas that get to our main concerns while allowing the other side to make a presentation to their body politic that is more acceptable. Our main concern here is making sure that if Iran doesn't abide by its agreement, that we don't have to jump through a whole bunch of hoops in order to reinstate sanctions. That's our main concern. And I think that goal of having in reserve the possibility of putting back and applying forceful sanctions in the event of a violation, that goal can be met. And it'll require some creative negotiations by John Kerry and others, and I'm confident we'll be successful. And I very much appreciate, by the way, the support that has been provided by Prime Minister Renzi, as well as his former foreign minister, who now is the EU representative in many of these discussions. And with respect to the Russian sales, I will tell you this is actually a sale that was slated to happen in 2009, when I first met with then Prime Minister Putin. They actually stopped the sale, paused or suspended the sale at our request. I'm frankly surprised that it held this long, given that they were not prohibited by sanctions from selling these defensive weapons. When I say I'm not surprised, given some of the deterioration in the relationship between Russia and the United States, and the fact that their economy is under strain, and this was a substantial sale, I do think that it sends a message about how important it is for us to look like we are credible in negotiations if, in fact, a deal fails and we are needing to maintain sanctions. Because I've heard some in Congress who are opposed to this deal say, either let's just slap on even more sanctions, or we'll do sanctions unilaterally regardless of what other countries are willing to do. The reason that the sanctions regime has worked is because painstakingly we built an international coalition that has held this long. And if it is perceived that we walked away from a fair deal that gives us assurances Iran doesn't get a nuclear weapon, then those international sanctions will fray. And it won't just be Russia or China, it'll be some of our close allies who will start questioning our capacity or the wisdom of maintaining these. We don't want to put ourselves in that position. We want to make sure that if there is no deal around the Iran nuclear program, it's because the Iranians were not willing to accept what the international community considered to be an appropriate and fair approach to this problem. Okay? Phew. All right. Oh, see, I'm still not finished. Let me just say this about Loretta Lynch. We've actually seen some outbreaks of bipartisanship and common sense in Congress over the last couple of weeks. Yesterday I signed the SGR fix that initiates not only some real reforms around how our healthcare system works, but expands insurance for children. We just talked about what I think was at least a constructive process to resolve the question of congressional involvement in Iran. And yet, what we still have is this crazy situation where a woman who everybody agrees is qualified, who has gone after terrorists, who has worked with police officers to get gangs off the streets, who is trusted by the civil rights community and by police unions as being somebody who's fair and effective and a good manager. Nobody suggests otherwise. Who's been confirmed twice before by the United States Senate for one of the biggest law enforcement jobs in the country, has been now sitting there longer than the previous seven attorney general nominees combined. And there's no reason for it. Nobody can describe a reason for it beyond political gamesmanship in the Senate on an issue that's completely unrelated to her. This is the top law enforcement job in the country. It's my attorney general who has to interact with his Italian counterparts or her Italian counterparts in dealing with counterterrorism issues, in dealing with Interpol, in dealing with our national security, in coordinating with our FBI. What are we doing here? And I have to say that there are times where the dysfunction in the Senate just goes too far. This is an example of it. It's gone too far. Enough. Enough. Call Loretta Lynch for a vote. Get her confirmed. Put her in place. Let her do her job. This is embarrassing, a process like this. Thank you.
About the situation of migrants in the Mediterranean Sea. I think Mediterranean is a sea and not a cemetery. The problem in this moment is the situation on ground in Libya. We discussed about Mr. President or the President. If you think about 91% of the people who come from Africa to Italy come from Libya. So, exactly as 3 years ago, when the people come from Tunisia, because the problem was the lack of stability in Tunisia, today the only way is come back to the peace and stability of the Libyan institutions. Obviously, it's not easy. We work every day to find a solution with the United Nations and then with other partners and friends and allies in the region. But I think the only way is come back to stability in Libya. In this period of transition, Italy is ready to bring responsibility to make the leadership in every diplomatic and counter-terrorism efforts. But the key point is stop human trafficking in Mediterranean Sea is a priority for everybody in Europe, and for me is absolutely crucial. The words of the President Obama is a priority also for the United States. Stop human trafficking is the only way to give a perspective of justice and also of security, obviously, of course, for the risks of this area. I think there are not problem of clash of religions in Italy. Maybe yesterday, maybe there were one case about it, but the problem is not a problem of clash of religions. It's a problem of human dignity. We are absolutely committed to solve this problem, and I'm confident if this become a priority, we achieve a great result.
La lotta all'ISIS in Libia, lei ha appena detto, l'Italia è pronta a prendersi responsabilità sia a livello diplomatico che a livello di attività antiterrorismo. Allora le vorrei chiedere quali sono i protagonisti della regione che secondo lei dovrebbero essere gli interlocutori principali per cercare di arrivare alla stabilità in Libia, e che cosa significa esattamente attività antiterrorismo, se l'Italia è pronta a mandare i 5.000 uomini di cui ha più volte parlato, con quali modalità, e se ha chiesto oggi al Presidente Obama magari il sostegno americano in specifiche attività antiterrorismo, magari con l'uso di droni. And for President Obama, if I can, first of all, if you can we expect anytime soon specific counter-terrorism action of the United States in Libya? And then concerning Russia, President Renzi has been the last G7 leader in Moscow. Do you think it was useful? And did you ask and get any specific commitments for the renewal of the sanction against Russia? Thank you.
Parto dalla questione che lei ha posto sulla Libia. Ripeto ciò che ho detto. È evidente che tutti i paesi della regione sono paesi interessati a trovare una soluzione. Tutti, nessuno escluso. Noi apprezziamo molto il lavoro che alcuni paesi stanno finalmente facendo a partire dall'area del Mediterraneo, del Nord Africa, a cominciare dall'Egitto. Dunque tutti i paesi fanno parte di questa grande impresa, ma mi permetta di essere molto chiaro. La pace in Libia o la fanno le tribù o non la fa nessuno. L'unico modo per fare la pace in Libia è che le tribù finalmente accettino di fare un passo verso la stabilizzazione e verso la pace. E il nostro lavoro è quello di cercare di favorire, agevolare a tutti i livelli questo sforzo per la pace. Le iniziative diplomatiche le conosce, sono quelle che si stanno svolgendo sotto la guida dell'ONU di Bernardino León, ma sono anche quelle che i ministri degli esteri stanno studiando, cercando di supportare. Un lavoro che non è un lavoro che inizia in Libia. Io vorrei che fosse chiaro agli amici giornalisti italiani che la Libia, che noi consideriamo giustamente, essendo di fronte a noi il principale problema, è una parte di un problema più complessivo che riguarda naturalmente il rischio di infiltrazioni terroristiche in Africa. Abbiamo nel cuore il dolore per ciò che è accaduto in Kenya all'Università di Garissa, ma che riguarda l'Africa in tutto il continente. Esattamente qualche giorno fa abbiamo ricordato che è passato già un anno da quando qualche centinaio di ragazze sono state rapite da Boko Haram, l'hashtag Bring Back Our Girls è un imperativo morale per ciascuno di noi. Dunque, la questione della Libia è una questione che va inserita in un ragionamento più ampio. Le soluzioni tecniche i team le continuano a vedere giorno dopo giorno e sono ovviamente soluzioni tecniche nelle quali c'è una piena consapevolezza. L'Italia sta al fianco degli Stati Uniti, l'Europa sta al fianco degli Stati Uniti in una grande sfida, che porterà ad esempio le truppe del nostro paese a restare in Afghanistan mesi in più rispetto a ciò che si era immaginato. Perché se la coalizione e gli Stati Uniti ritengono che ancora il processo deve continuare, bene, l'Italia farà sempre la propria parte. Naturalmente, nel merito delle soluzioni tecniche, queste non sono oggetto delle discussioni politiche, ma sono affrontate dai team tecnici. Per me è molto importante avere la assicurazione di priorità da parte del Presidente degli Stati Uniti, avere la consapevolezza che questa partita non è una partita in cui l'Italia è sola, e le posso garantire che, per quello che ci riguarda, la collaborazione e la cooperazione continua sia nei livelli naturali diplomatici che nel costante lavoro di tutti i giorni, che è un lavoro che viene portato avanti nel silenzio, nella quotidianità, e che porta, mi permetta di dire, all'eroismo. Penso a quelle donne e gli uomini della Guardia Costiera che hanno salvato dei migranti in mare o che hanno consentito a una giovane migrante di partorire a bordo di una nave. Stava morendo, sono state salvate due vite. Ecco, credo che questo sia quello che noi vogliamo fare. Ma contemporaneamente dobbiamo anche avere piena consapevolezza che il lavoro che svolgiamo insieme è un lavoro che non riguarda soltanto la Libia, ma che riguarda tutta l'Africa, mi verrebbe da dire tutto il mondo, ed è un lavoro, mi permetta di dirlo senza rubare la domanda al Presidente Obama, che noi continuiamo a fare ovunque, dalla Russia all'America Latina, dall'Afghanistan fino al Medio Oriente. La collaborazione e cooperazione dell'Italia con gli Stati Uniti è fuori discussione.
We are consistently looking where terrorist threats might emanate, and Libya obviously is an area of great concern. ISIL has been very explicit about wanting to use the chaos inside of Libya as a potential justification for putting some of their personnel there. And so the coordination with Italy and with other of our key partners is going to be very important. We will not be able to solve the problem just with a few drone strikes or a few military operations. You have a country that has been broken into a number of tribal factions. There's some sectarian elements to it. And you don't have a central government that is functioning effectively. So we still have to guard against the use of the territories in Libya as a safe haven for terrorist operations, much in the way we've done with respect to Somalia for many years. But the answer ultimately is to have a government that can control its own borders and work with us. That's going to take some time. But we will combine counterterrorism efforts in cooperation with Italy and other like-minded nations with a political effort. And we're going to have to encourage some of the countries inside of the Gulf who have, I think, influence over the various factions inside of Libya to be more cooperative themselves. In some cases, you've seen them fan the flames of military conflict rather than try to reduce them. With respect to Russia, Matteo and I agree that we need implementation of Minsk. And I expressed my strong belief that the European Council needs to continue the current sanctions that are in place until we've seen full implementation of the Minsk Agreement. There will be a vote coming up this summer in the European Council, and my expectation is not only Italy, but all countries in Europe will recognize that it would be a wrong message to send to reduce sanctions pressure on Russia when their key implementation steps don't happen until the end of the year. At minimum, we have to maintain the existing sanction levels until we've seen that they've carried out the steps that they're required to under the agreement. One of the things that Matteo and I share, and I think the Italian people and the American people share, is a sense of values and principles that sometimes override political expediency. That's part of our DNA, that's part of our memories, because of the history of both our countries. And I think we have to be realistic and practical in how we look at a problem like Ukraine. But we have to also recall that the reason there is a unified and prosperous Europe is because enormous sacrifices were made on behalf of ideals and on behalf of principles. And if those principles of territorial integrity and sovereignty start getting ignored, then that carries a cost for Europe and for the world. Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. All right. Thank you.